Very good evening to all of you who have logged into this wonderful webinar here. We are going to have a webinar for 60 minutes, out of which there are going to be two talks of 15 minutes each, and then we are going to have question answer sessions. I'm Dr. Sachin Kaye from Pune, and I'm going to be your moderator for today. The topic for the webinar today is True Trifocal Requirement. It ends with the Acriva Trinovalence. VSY Biotechnology is marketing and manufacturing these lenses, and I am glad to inform you that there would be a series of webinars that the company would be doing over the next couple of months. We have two wonderful speakers here, very eminent speakers, prolific surgeons. We have Dr. Anaga Herur, who is the medical director for Anil Eye Hospital at Dombivli. Amongst a list of laureates that she has, the latest one is she's become the ARC member for West Zone at AIOS. The next speaker that we have is Dr. Sucheta Parija. She is the additional professor and head of department at All India Medical Sciences, Bhubaneswar.
Hi.
So they'll be talking to you about two different subjects. We can right away go to the first presentation that is going to be by Dr. Anaga Herur, and she's going to be talking to you about the right selection of trifocal IOL managing a dissatisfied patient. Anaga, you can take over. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sachin, and a very good evening to all of you friends, and a very warm welcome to this webinar. At the outset, even before I begin my presentation, my salutations to the frontline heroes of the COVID battle today that we are facing, and hoping that in all these difficult times, you are all safe and healthy. No financial interest in any of the products that I would be mentioning in my presentation. Friends, today, if we were to compare monofocal IOLs versus multifocal IOLs with regard to the effort that a surgeon needs to put in versus the satisfaction that the patient would get. If you think of a monofocal IOL, definitely the satisfaction that you would get would be restricted to a good distance vision. I would not be belittling the effort of the surgeon though. Regarding the multifocal intraocular lens, definitely the effort that would be put in by the surgeon would be much higher, and we would expect that the satisfaction of the patient also would be much greater. So today, friends, let us see how we can increase that satisfaction in the patients and what is the extra effort that we need to put in order to achieve that. Yes, clear accommodative vision is the holy grail that all of us as ophthalmologists would want to give to our patients. And today, this intermediate vision is something that all of us want to give, and that is the need of the hour. So, ye dil mange more. However, regarding the prohibitive cost of the lenses that are present today, and the fear that a patient would be dissatisfied, would probably complain of glare and halos, and would probably end up causing us to do an intraocular lens exchange, would probably be the reason why the use of multifocal or trifocal IOLs would be restricted to somewhere around 10%, plus minus depending on the individual practices. These challenges are because of various reasons, and let us divide it into preoperative, intraoperative, and in the postoperative period. Definitely, patient selection is important, and this would be dealt with by Dr. Sucheta. Intraocular lens selection and counseling is extremely important. Needless to say, precise biometry and surgery is important, and we would also see how we can manage a dissatisfied patient. Definitely, our patients need to be motivated and have realistic expectations. They should believe in you. And if it's a totally hypercritical patient, I would avoid it. The way you actually start working up this patient is important. Now, this is not just similar to a monofocal IOL patient. So in my center, we take repeat readings and ensure that they are consistent. All the readings need to be taken on a virgin eye before any kind of drops, either a dilating drop or an anesthetic drop, are put into the eye. A perfect biometry is essential. I would always advise an optical biometry in these cases. Now, if the patient has astigmatism, see to it that it is not an irregular astigmatism. The topography should be regular. OCT is usually performed for all these patients to see that it is normal. However, if the patient has any kind of retinal problems or glaucoma, corneal opacities or severe dry eye, we would definitely avoid. Intraoperative problems like a significant PC tear and zonular dialysis can give rise to decentration, and we would avoid putting a multifocal in these patients. In a case of a previous refractive surgery done, there is already a multifocality in the cornea, so there would be higher chance of an unpredictable outcome. There would be higher order aberrations, like for this case, for example, if it's a decentered ablation, definitely the amount of coma would be high, higher spherical aberrations would be high. And hitting hemotropia would be difficult because the K-metry readings are not probably accurate in these cases. So we would avoid a multifocal IOL. So ideally, if it is less than 0.75, you would definitely go ahead. If it is more than that, you discuss the options of how you would plan the surgery with the patient with regard to a toric multifocal or an LRI or a laser touch-up in the as a secondary procedure. Now, just like an ideal wife or a perfect husband, I think even an ideal multifocal IOL is equally elusive. So the choice for us as ophthalmologists is going to be difficult, and we could be confused by the too many choices that we have today. So what we finally end up is being a matchmaker. What we need to do is communicate with the patient regarding what are his visual expectations, what are his work and leisure related activities. I evaluate what is the kind of personality of the patient, what are his lifestyle choices, and then go ahead and decide what is the functionally optimum lens that you would use for this patient. Even before you go ahead with a thought of a multifocal IOL, remember, monovision is also an option that you can give the patient. However, there could be a severe reduction in stereo acuity, and if there is a strong ocular dominance, it can result in asthenopia. So even if you would probably go with a sweet spot of a 1 to 1.5 diopter monovision, the patient needs to be explained about this, and not all patients would accept it readily. Regarding the intermediate vision, that is what we are going to focus on today. So basically, a trifocal IOL is a combination of two kyphoform profiles with different step heights. So because of a combination of these two profiles, you get good distance vision, you get good near vision, and fairly good intermediate vision. So today, if I were to decide which kind of lens I would put in a patient, and if the patient wants spectacle independence, I would ask the patient three questions. The first question would be if the patient does a lot of night driving. Now, if the patient is regularly doing night driving, I would probably avoid putting a multifocal lens in these patients. If the patient does it sometimes, then definitely you counsel about the possibility of glare. And if the night driving is more important to the patient than the spectacle independence, again, avoid. However, if the patient accepts it, or if the patient doesn't do night driving, then definitely you can go ahead with the multifocal IOL patient. Now, second question is, how much is the patient working on the intermediate vision, like a computer or a laptop? If he's doing it regularly, then my first lens of choice is a trifocal or an ad-off with a micromonovision. If the patient is doing it only sometimes and he's affording it, then definitely trifocal is the first choice. But if he doesn't afford it, then he can put a bifocal lens, but you need to counsel the patient. If there is no computer use at all, then you can go ahead with a bifocal or multifocal patient and use a lens according to the reading distance and then decide the near addition. Now, how would you decide what would be the near add to be used? Now, what we do usually is to give the patient a reading card upside down. So when he actually straightens it out, he would hold it according to his routine reading distance. And just like in a routine refraction for presbyopia, the nearer he holds it, you would give a greater add. So if it's around 40 centimeters, you would probably go in for a 3 or a plus 3.25 add. However, no matter what lens is chosen, be sure that you tell the patient that you are not promising him 100% spectacle independence. And probably in certain cases, especially in mesopic conditions, he would probably still need to use some kind of glasses for very fine print or very small fine things at some point of time. Again, depending on the physical factors, if it's a tall patient, you would probably use a lesser rad compared to a shorter patient with shorter arms. Now, what was the difference? Now, if you have a greater rad, it probably has more rings and that would probably end up having more halos. So nowadays, we prefer lower rads. Again, trifocals will give you a win-win situation because you would get good distance vision, good near vision, and good intermediate vision. However, if one were to use a bifocal multifocal IOL, probably you would need to mix and match with a plus 3 or plus 2.5, or you can use an add-off which gives you good intermediate and distance, but for you could use a plus 3.25 in the other eye, or you could use a monofocal in one eye and probably something which would give you a good distance and intermediate in the other eye. So all these choices and options are available. Now, suppose you were to do the first eye, the dominant eye, and you have put a multifocal IOL, usually I would do a refraction, say, in a week's time. And if the vision is perfect for distance as well as near, yes, you could go ahead with the same lens, same ad. Sometimes you do a refraction even on the first or the second day post-op, depending on the requirement and the need of the patient. We actually do it as a protocol even on the first day post-op. If the patient is not happy with the near vision and he needs a near vision extra, so you can either do a micro mono vision with a target of minus 0.5 or you can use a low power ad multifocal in the other eye. Now, if a patient is a low myope, remember they are used to reading without glasses, you need to carefully counsel them. They may not really think it's a great idea because they already have good near vision. Moderate hyperopes are that way the happiest because they are now getting to read much better even without glasses. If it's a diabetic patient since a few years and absolutely well controlled with no diabetic retinopathy, you need to go ahead, you counsel, control, and then caution them in case of future problems that they need to keep on monitoring their retinal condition. However, if it's a chronic long-standing diabetic with already signs of BDR already settled in, I would probably avoid depending on the status of the patient. Another red flag is a one-eyed patient. You can use it with caution if the patient demands it and insists on it, but remember there is no binocular summation effect. Now, for example, this is a patient, a 36-year-old patient, male patient, unilateral cataract. The other eye is a clear lens. Would you go in for a mono or a multifocal IOL patient? Now, here, most probably, this could be a secondary cataract after a recurrent uveitis. Even if you see some kind of KPs or old KPs on the endothelium, remember, these patients are to be avoided and are red flags. If the first eye has been used a multifocal IOL, would you still go ahead in the other eye if there has been a problem in the first eye? For example, this is a patient who came to me. You can see how the pupil is distorted, decentered, little iris atrophic patches are seen. YAC capsulotomy has been done and the patient is accepting around minus one and a plus two add also. So definitely I would not go in for a multifocal in this eye for the second eye. Now, depending on the pupillary size, if a patient has a very large pupil, they are already at a risk of dysphotopsia. And remember, doubling the pupillary diameter would increase the spherical aberration to 16 times. So if a patient has a really large pupil, probably it would be better to avoid, especially if he is doing a lot of night driving. However, those who are having smaller pupils are blessed because they automatically have an increased depth of focus, especially in very senile patients. This could automatically help in their near vision. And if the patient has a pupillary size of less than 2 or 3 millimeters, maybe it would not give the proper or the complete benefit of a multifocal IOL. If the patient has a small pupil and it would necessitate the use of some kind of pupillary expanding devices, remember, if you would use iris hooks like this, you can cause pupillary distortion and a sphincter tears like this, which could increase the amount of glare and halo. So you should avoid in such cases. Intraoperative considerations. Remember, you need to have a perfect incision, a perfect CCC, a perfect phaco, and a perfect IOL centration. Now let us see a few cases. Now this is a patient of a soft cataract. So you're having an incision, it is perfectly engineered incision. Their CCC has to be completely actually circular centered perfectly well. A good hydro dissection to delineate the endonucleus. Remember, there have to be minimal manipulations, minimal fluctuations of the anterior chamber. And if it's a soft cataract, then you can actually prolapse one of the edges of the nucleus into the anterior chamber. The phaco should be done well away from the endothelium to prevent any kind of endothelial decompensation. This is the irrigation aspiration being done. A very perfect surgery should be done. Now, this is the Trinova lens that we are using here. It's a plate haptic lens with, you can see the hole also on one of the haptics on the left side. And see that all the edges are tucked very well inside the edges of the cartridge, and the cartridge is then loaded onto the injector. A little bit of viscoelastic is also injected at the tip of the injector, and it beautifully opens out into the capsular bag, and it is nudged inside the capsular bag. You can see it is 11 by 6 millimeters. It's a plus 20 lens here. The Acriva Trinova lens is extremely flexible and easy to use, and here we are removing the viscoelastic from behind the lens also to prevent any kind of decentration. It's absolutely stable, and you can see that you need to center the lens on the visual axis. Ask the patient to keep looking at the light of the microscope. Now, in basically being a plate haptic and having a central diameter of 1.4 millimeters, this allows for even a slight decentration or in a large kappa angle, it is more tolerant. Now, this was an interesting patient, a patient of floppy iris. You can see how the pupil was coming down even at the beginning of surgery. So this patient wanted a multifocal IOL, so we decided to use a B-hex ring. So I'm using a 23 gauge forceps in the right hand and putting up all the three flanges underneath the iris. And you get a good, adequately dilated pupillary size of a hexagonal shape. You go ahead and do all your steps of surgery, the hydro dissection and the phaco emulsification can be done extremely effortlessly. Even the irrigation aspiration is done. And once the intraocular lens is implanted into the capsular bag, you can now go ahead and remove the B-hex ring with the 23 gauge forceps extremely easily. Post-operatively, this patient did very well with a 6-6-N6 with the lens perfectly centered in the bag. Now, I have mentioned earlier in my presentation regarding avoiding the use of multifocal IOLs in post-keratorefractive surgeries. But here I would like to present a very interesting case of a 47-year-old patient with a four-cut RK who had cataract, and you can see the cornea is a very flat K. This is the corneal topography of the patient. And by doing IOL Master 700, you can see that using the SRKT formula, what we got was an 18.5 diopters. You can also see that what we have written here is how much the patient is using computer. So it was all day, reading was for 2 hours, and there was no night driving. Now this patient, we also, obviously SRKT is not what needs to be used. So we went ahead with a Barrett TrueK and a prior RK ASCRS online calculator. Now you can see that compared to the 18.5 that was recommended by SRKT, what is recommended by the Barrett is around 20, and that is why that is important. In fact, the ASCRS online calculator is a combination of multiple formulas, so it is much more accurate. So we went ahead with a 20 diopter lens. Again, in these cases, it's important to do a pentacam. This is the Holiday EKR report, and you can see here that the histogram is showing a tall peak with very less variability on the keratometry, which prompted us to go ahead with a multifocal IOL. So the patient was given a proper guided visual prognosis. He was also counseled about the risk of a residual refractive error and night vision issues, glare, halos. The patient accepted everything. And then we went ahead with this surgery. A trifocal lens was put in this patient. And post-operatively, in fact, the patient did extremely well and is happy. In fact, we have done the second eye after almost 1.5 years after the first eye, and he's doing well. Now, femtosecond laser surgery is now increasingly being used. So this is the catalyst system that we are using in our center. We are doing the capsulotomy and the nucleotomy here. This gives an extremely well-centered capsulotomy flap, and in fact, one of the greatest advantages is you can actually center it on the capsular bag rather than just on the pupil. And definitely, nucleotomy, which is already done, especially if the cataracts are more harder or in brown cataracts, would definitely help us to reduce the amount of echo energy that is used. So very easily, the surgery and effortlessly can be done. The nucleus is phaco emulsified, and you can go ahead with the irrigation and aspiration. Now remember, the femto laser actually cuts all the cortical fibers also vertically. So when you are doing an irrigation aspiration, you need to really tease off the cortical fibers from the periphery. This could be one difference compared to your routine surgery, but you can see how the rexus is absolutely well centered. So when you're using a trifocal lens like this, definitely such kind of consistency in your and repeatability in the rexus and the CCC is definitely important. And the centration of the trifocal lens becomes even better. So I would really advise if you have an access to flax, definitely these are premium surgeries, and doing a premium lens in these patients, you could give them better visual outcomes. This was the patient, next day 6-6 and 6. Now, counseling in all these patients has to be very, very good, because a greater chair time initially would save you a lot of headache later on. They need to be also asked for a special consent. In our center, we do it, and also regarding neuroadaptation. Now, if a patient is not satisfied, and the reason is because he expects more than what he has got, always remember under promise and over deliver. So where do you start from? So these are the various reasons why a patient could be dissatisfied. Let us go into a bit of detail into these things. The most common cause is if there's a residual refractive error, especially if it's a cylinder. So first of all, identify where you have gone wrong. So whenever you do a refraction, now sometimes there could be an autorefractometer showing just say a 0.5 or so. Remember to tell your optometrist or technician not to blurt out. A patient may be 6-6 and 6, but just because there's an autoref reading of 0.5 doesn't mean that he needs to use glasses. However, if there is a significant residual refractive error, remember first go back and check if your biometry was normal or not, if it was perfect or not. If there is a residual spherical error or a cylindrical error, if it's say less than 1, 1.5, you may be able to do a touch up once everything is settled with a PRK or a LASIK. However, if it is greater than 1.5, you might have to go in for an IOL exchange. Now, all these patients are extremely sensitive to PCO. So even if there are wrinkles, not even a PCO exactly, they could have a lot of contrast loss, and then you might need to go ahead with a larger capsulotomy than usual. But remember, once the YAG has been done, it would be extremely difficult to do IOL exchange. So be very sure what exactly is the reason of the patient's dissatisfaction. CME has to be detected early, and this is one of the causes why the patient would come back to you with a blurred vision. Detect early, treat early. A lot of our patients could have ocular surface disease. If it's not detected in the preoperative period, they could come back with problems. Even if they are 6-6 senses, only their problems of pricking and burning sensation itself could eat your head. Nowadays, we are doing a dry eye workup for all our multifocal, trifocal patients. There are some patients whom we have treated with IPL treatment also, no financial interest, and patients have improved significantly. A good IOL centration is important. If there is any kind of decentration, asymmetric CCC, then definitely these patients could go in for a complaint. Especially in trinova patients, we have found that it is more tolerant to decentration. So no matter what diffractive lens you use, there is going to be some kind of light loss, almost up to 18% in usual cases, much, much lesser in the trinova lens. So these patients are prone to getting glare and halos. So in our experience, we have found with the trinova lens, 100% of patients did 6-9 or better, more than 90% had 6-6 for distance vision. More than 90% of them were good for intermediate and near, and just 10% needed a little more light for near vision, that's all. Now, if a patient actually complains of glare and halos, remember to reassure them that yes, this means that the lens is working. However, if it is absolutely unacceptable, you can go ahead and use brimonidine eye drops. Remember, this is one of the commonest reasons of an IOL exchange. different patients would respond differently. So those patients who are younger and easygoing, more motivated, would adapt faster. But patients may take as many as few weeks to 12 months to undergo complete neuroadaptation. Now, angle kappa is something which also needs to be thought of. Now, we all know that angle kappa and angle alpha are extremely important. If you see this picture image, the blue line is the blue point is the visual axis here. The red one is the pupillary center and the yellow spot is the optical center. Now, ideally, the multifocal or the trifocal lens should be centered on the visual axis, but at best, it can be between the visual axis and the pupillary center. So this is the green, that is the center of the multifocal intraocular lens. Now, how would you measure angle alpha or angle kappa? So you can use various instruments like the eye trace. Here you can use the IOL Master 700, where the addition of the PX and PY should not be more than 0.6. You can also use the NIDEC OPD scan. So here you can see this is the NIDEC OPD scan of a patient. On the left, you can see the visual axis is directly on, bang on in the center of the multifocal lens. But here you can see this is the center of the lens, but the visual axis is somewhere here. And this patient complained of a lot of glare and halos. So this is how in the post-operative period, you can actually pick up these patients. So to conclude, friends, we have promising new technologies today and you can give the patients better visual outcomes and they can be really happier. And we can now with all this, go ahead and accept the challenge of all these patients. But beware, your multifocal IOL patient is like your loving wife. You give her all your time and treat her properly and she'll make life heaven for you. However, if you don't give them the required attention, they can really make life hell for you. Before I sign off, friends, Joseph Borrell commented that COVID-19 will reshape our world. We don't know yet when the crisis will end. But yes, we can be sure that by the time it does, our world will look very different. So to all my friends here, stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you so much for your kind hearing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anaga. That was an excellent presentation with a lot of things that people can learn from you. I just request all the participants who have logged in to type in your queries and I will be taking them up one by one once both the talks are over. We are through with the first talk. And now I would request Dr. Sucheta Prija to kindly go ahead with her talk. And her talk is going to be on my experience of patient selection for trifocals and my experience on Acriva Trinova. Sucheta, please.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. So my topic is my preference for patient selection for trifocal and experience with the Acriva trifocal. I have no financial interest in this presentation. Well, as technology advances and new innovation comes in, so the patient's expectation is also increasing and the demand is increasing. And we actually don't have what we call as the perfect IOL till now, and that is also evolving. So in this scenario, let's actually go ahead and see how I do my preference of selecting some of these cases for trifocals. So let's come to the first case. It is a 56-year-old male who is an IT professional, tennis player with the best corrected visual acuity of 6x6 in the right eye and 6x18 in the left eye. And on slit lamp, you can see he is having a posterior subcapsular cataract, fundus sosa, juxtafoveal soft drusens. But if you did the OCT, fovea was spared, corneal topo was normal, no medical history. So in this case, what do you think? Which IOL you have such options of so many IOLs with you, which IOL will you go for? So my selection was the patient was having an active lifestyle. He was more into a computer work and also he was having a night driving. So the thing is, and he did not have so much of an active ARMD, and you know, 56 years, do not know how much he will have this with ARMDs. So we went ahead and did a trifocal for this patient and the patient is doing well. Coming to the second case, this is a 43-year female who is a dancer with one eye operated 8 months back with a monofocal IOL. She's a diabetic since 12 years and she has come for surgery for cataract. the left eye, and fundus is showing mild non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. And what she's insisting is she doesn't want any spectacles because she has to perform and she's having problem for that. Well, for this case, what options you have? Now, since the thing is she's already a demanding person, her profession is she needs something to do away with spectacles, and already one eye has been operated. Now she's having a good distance vision, so why not go in and do a trifocal in the left eye for her? We thought where she will have a good near and distance vision also. Well, she has a diabetic, which is actually not a contraindication because her diabetic profile was normal and she did not have so much of a non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. But well, in this case, this, if you have a very advanced diabetic retinopathy changes or PDR or vitreous hemorrhage, well, no. And if you know the patient will never have a compliance and there is a fluctuating blood sugar and you know very early they will progress, well, you should not put a trifocal in those cases. Coming to the third scenario, this is a 49-year-old housewife. What thing is that? She was an artist. So she was a piano player as well as artist. She has a primary open-angle glaucoma for 3 years and is on Lumican. She's having a bilateral cataract. If you can see, right eye, it is nuclear sclerosis grade 3, but the left eye is having a posterior polar cataract. Visual fields are showing some nasal steps. Disc ranges are 0.5 and 0.7 cupping. Intraocular pressure is 14 millimeter of mercury. Now, what options do you give for this cases? Now, what I wanted to say is that, like, if you have a stable visual field and it is not progressing, and the distance is not much, and you know that the patient is quite compliant with her medication, well, this is not a contraindication. So you can go well because she wants a intermittent and near vision. You can go off and have a trifocal. But the click is how competent you are, because there is a posterior polar cataract. If you do any rent in these cases, well, you have promised the patient with a near and a very good intermittent vision, then you have to think about it, what you will explain to the patient. One more thing, if it is a pseudo exfoliation, well, no, in those cases. So the dilemma for right intraocular choice, it depends on two things. What I see is, what patient's characteristics is ideal for implanting a trifocal IOLs. Look into the lifestyle, what exactly the lifestyle is, and what is the visual demand of the patient is, and what does the patient expect, and what should be your realistic expectation in these cases. So it's always better to educate and inform the patient about all the intraocular lenses, its pros and cons, let them decide for themselves which IOL they want. The second is, what ocular pathology should we avoid for putting trifocal intraocular lenses? Well, a patient with a severe dry eye, any corneal pathology with an irregular astigmatism, macular scar, severe ischemic neuropathies, well, we do at all avoid giving a trifocal to these patients. Well, what is important, and Dr. Anagha has beautifully said, is a preoperative workup, which is very important. So we have a lot of sophisticated tools, diagnostic tools with us, and you should have an accurate biometry. You should use the advanced IOL formulas, and you should be very careful in looking on the higher order aberrations. You should have a good surgical intervention where you don't make any intraoperative complications, no PCRs in those cases, good centering, and finally, you can have a good optimal outcome. So patient selection also is based on, look at the dry eyes, any fundus retinal pathology, any irregular astigmatism, as well as the lifestyle of the patient and what is their expectation and motivation. So all these are key to success. Now coming to this new technology, what they are talking about is the sinusoidal vision technology by Acriva Trinova. What exactly is this which has revolutionized the trifocal IOL group? So they are saying, what they are saying, there is a seamless vision for both for near, intermittent, and distance all together with not much of glares and good night vision. So what are the challenges with the conventional trifocals which was there? So if you look at this traditional diffractive IOLs, what they had this sharp edges. And because of that sharp edges, there was a light loss of 15% to 20%. And that led to visual disturbances due to scatter, and there is a blurring of vision at the transition zones, leading to glares and halos, and there was a fall in the mesopic vision and in night vision. So what they are saying, this new technology, that is the SVT is a unique patent, and what they have done, because of this technology, they have some surface modification which has been made, and instead of the sharp edges, what they are saying, they have a stepless zones in between, so you get a clear vision for all throughout. So it's just a next generation IOL, trifocal IOL, which is designed with the stepless zones, and it has 12 unique zones. So you can very well see here the zones which are there. So it has 12 unique zones, and there is the highest light transmission and optimal light distribution throughout all the optical diameters. So with that, lot of once more of light is going through it, so you don't have this visual disturbances more, and it has the excellent this modulation transfer factor, so you have a very better contrast sensitivity compared to the other trifocals. So if you look at this comment which has been given by Ehud Essia, who is the director of medical center at Tel Aviv, he's saying the second order light diffraction is effectively utilized in these lenses to provide the intermittent vision, thus gaining and focus at the intermittent zone with loss of defocused light such and side effects such as glare and reduced contrast sensitivity. So looking at the technical features of this Acriva Trinova, it is a foldable lens and what is, it's a co-polymer. Basically, it's a combination of hydrophilic and hydrophobic, and it's coming in the plate haptic with 11 millimeter overall diameter, and it is quite suitable for our MICS, and it has all enhanced square ranges, and it varies from range from 0 to 32 diopters. What do we see here when comparing with the other trifocals? If you see the defocus curve, it is quite smooth in this. And once there is a good defocus curve, the IOL performance is quite good in these cases. And you can have less of glares and halos compared to the other IOLs. That is, they have compared with the fine vision, they have compared with the Acrylisa, and they have compared with Panoptics. So these are some of the sharp edges and the smooth edges which is there in cases of Acriva Trinova. What they are talking about this lenses, unique feature is it has the maximum light transmission. So effective light transmission is around 92%, and they're saying. So light loss is 88%, which is minimum in the trifocal market. And when they're comparing with the other lenses, it varies from 12 to 15% or around 20% loss of light. So what is next is the balanced light distribution in both photopeak as well as the mesopeak conditions. And if you see the graph over here, there is a well distribution of light both for far, intermittent and for near. And because of this distribution, there is an enhanced performance under the low illumination, and night vision is good in these cases. This unique light distribution structure is that high amount of light is diffracted. So even at the zones of a larger pupil, it gives a greater visual performance at mesopeak conditions. And that is what, so glares and all are less at night. Now coming to what we are talking about, this photopeak phenomena. So mostly our patients are dissatisfied because of a lot of glares and halos which they get. And what they have been telling, this is affecting their quality of life. So this stray light, we have Sequanta stray light from Oculus, which can actually quantify it. And if you see the effect on visual performance of an increase of 0.1 log is comparable to losing one line of the visual acuity. So once this is, once a lot of light is not going through, the energy is less and this glares and halos are there. So more of this is there, the quality of life will also decrease. So there is a comparison, a study which has done by Labus et al, and they have compared the ocular stray light after implantation of the multifocal intraocular lenses, and you can see a lot of things over here, and this is where the trifocal stands, it's quite low, and that is why you have less of amount of this photic phenomena which is there. Next, they are talking about what is coming in the intermittent zone is the comfortable reading distance. So anyone who is using people, they need a near, they have to read the newspaper properly, they have to see their computer work. So that range from that 80 to 40, what they are saying, is seamless in these cases. And they have an add of plus 1.5 for the intermittent, and it's quite good for 60 to 80 centimeter reading distance. And it's quite good in the near for around 40 centimeters. So this is how the reading performance is there, and you can very well see this. Yeah, so I'm showing for all the for distance, and this is for intermittent, and how she's going about, yes, reading for intermittent and then for near. So yeah, so that is what a seamless vision in all throughout, and they can very well clearly go about doing the intermittent work. So this lens was in the Innovators 2017 issue of the Ophthalmologist, and near, middle, far, and everything in between, and a seamless vision, that is what IOList are making in the market. So what are the other benefits of SVT? It has a quite a tolerance on the biometry measurement deviation. It can take up to 0.5 to 7.5 diopter post-operative refractive surprises. Slight post-operative tilts or even a higher kappa angle can be taken care of, and minimized dysphotopic phenomena is there. So what I want to say over here is, when they had, there was a study which has been done by Dr. Pavel, and he has done his study on Trinova with the this I think with the fine vision, and what he has seen that the glares and halos are there, but it is comparatively less. And what they have seen that most of his 10 cases which initially he has seen, they have been a point 0.05 myopia, but patient did not complain, and they were quite happy with the lens also. So that tolerance power is taken up with this VST technology. So this is our first case which we implanted in our center. This was basically a 67-year-old male who was banker, and he wanted a near vision as well, because he had a difficulty doing computer and near work. He did not want glasses, and we went about, did a good Rexis, which Anaga was talking with. Very, very important. Your Rexis size should be very good. If you don't have a flax with you, you should be having a good manual Rexis. And then what we are saying, it's quite easy, and it can go through a 1.8 millimeter also, but this is around 2.2. And what is important is it has a good, it's unfolding very easily, comfortably, and you should see that the mark, that mark should be in the left side, and you can notch one of the ends into the capsular bag. It goes smoothly, and you don't have to touch the center, just smoothly it can go in, and you just center it in the center it properly, so that the centration is good in this cases. So once this sits in, it is going to sit in. And very beautifully, they have done also a study, and they have seen that the actually this lens sits well with the IOCT. They have seen sits very well near the posterior capsule. So PCO formation is not much in this cases also. So this is how the loading part just. It is also quite efficient. You can load this lenses, and the thing is, you can give BSS or can OVD, and then you, one thing is, don't touch the center. That is the thing. You can with a tying forceps or anything, you can just hold it at the edges and bring it to the center, and be very careful when you are seeing that the optics should be in the middle before you just close, and you can hear that tick sound when it is coming, and it's ready. You can load it, put sufficient visco, and then you can make it sit inside the plunger. And this plunger is also something which is there, and that helps you to have the scar marks. So it is not there, the scar marks which is there. So these are some other cases where we have implanted the intraocular lens, and one thing, it sits in very beautifully, and you can see the clear rings. So next day, when you see this patient in the slit lamp, you actually cannot make out this rings which is there. And these are sharing some of our cases with you. So coming to the experience which we had from the initial, we have done around 19 cases, but the initial what we have done is, we were very spectacle initially when we are taking. So we were choosing more of housewives, those who are lucky, yeah, they won't have much of a complaint. So we were taking that, but what we saw is, every one of them had a very good distance vision. Intermittent vision was good initial part. And if you see, some of the patients had a problem with the near, one or two. So our sample size is less, so it will be more, but all of the patients had a good patient the satisfaction. So this is our visual outcome at 1 month and 3 months after surgery. So monocular uncorrected distance vision was very good in these cases, and intermittent distance at 80 and 60, that is what, so that range which they are giving extended range, and it's like a idea of what they are talking about. So at 40, and it was gaining, it was becoming more good at 3 months. And, well, the range of 25, that more you bring closer, then they had a decrease in the vision, but the further. So that is why that 30 to 40, what we are saying, is becoming a near for us. That is what our study was showing. Now, we did our patient satisfaction with the NF questionnaire, and overall satisfaction was very good, around 94.7. Three, and with the subscale, when we saw the general vision, the far activities, the close activities, and how the driving was, it was very good. So what we conclude from this is there are halos and glares. It's not that it is fully gone with these lenses, but people actually don't complain about that. And if you keep on asking, maybe they will share that with you. But yes, near vision may be a very near vision may be a problem, but the intermittent vision is quite good, and it has a good range. That is what it has come out with. So looking into the literature and looking into the planetary satellite symposium of ECRS various 2018-19, we can see that most of these lenses have been in the Europe where they have implant and they have the highest study. Well, even Japan, Asian country, which has 114 eyes, well, our center, it is like 24 eyes, which we have done till now. And our results are correlating with this type of results, and patient satisfaction is very good. So if you ask the patient what type of eye will you have in the other eye, they say, yes, this lens only I'll be putting. And will you refer it to others? Yes, they're quite happy to have this type of a lens in their eyes. So the take-home message is the preliminary data is very good, encouraging both for distance and intermittent vision. Patients hardly report of any visual effects in the form of halos and glares, and night vision is quite good. So no much of visual disturbances in the mesopic conditions, and patient selection for premium IOL is based on not only on the lifestyle, the visual demand, the comorbidity which is existing, and also on the how good you have done a preoperative workup, so your as well as the surgeon's skill. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sucheta. Considering the time that we have, we'll just move on to the question answers. We have a list of questions, but I'll try and squeeze them into common ones. So the first one comes for Dr. Anaga. Is there any? Do you measure angle alpha in every case of multifocal implants? And what is your cutoff not to implant a multifocal lens?
Yeah, of course I measure in all my cases, and the cutoff is around 0.6 to 0.7. See, earlier the normal is 0.36. So ideally earlier my threshold was 0.4, but I slowly increase it. I used to refuse a lot of patients at 0.4 or 0.5. But now I have increased it to around 0.6 maximum to 0.7.
Thank you. And do you have any comparative studies of PCO with this Trinova lens and other lenses? Because I think our experience is too short about it right now. So a study would require a lot of Trinova lenses to be implanted to have a study. So yeah.
I've been using it since the last few months, but I think we need to also have a more long-term study on that and monitor these patients for it. So maybe at least after 6 months to 1 year, we will really know how, but as of now, the patients are doing really well.
And how much is the hydrophilic material chosen over hydrophobic, or does it make any difference? A question for both of you.
Yeah, definitely a purely hydrophobic lens, as far as what we have learned in all these years, would probably have the least incidence of a PCO. However, this is not just a purely hydrophilic lens. It is a combination of both, and that is why probably the risk of PCO would be much less compared to a purely hydrophilic lens. But I think time will tell, and we are very hopeful that these patients, as of now at least, they have a good stretch, and being a plate haptic lens, it actually stretches the back and is well centered. So if you really wash off all the viscoelastic from behind the lens, and the lens is well centered with a good overlap on all the sides with the anterior capsular rim, I think definitely the chances and risk of ECO would be less, but I think only time will tell. We need to monitor.
Yeah, since it is a copolymer and it has both the advantages of hydrophobic and hydrophilic, and what Ananga was saying, if you do a good IOL in the bag, and if you have done a good Rexus and it is sitting quite and it is having a this edge optics so haptic, so that will take care of the PCO. But now the time is, it is very quite small. We have only 3 months, few cases also, we don't know follow up in them for a longer time, will say actually what will happen to this cases.
Thank you. This question is for Dr. Sucheta. At the end of your surgery, the final resting position of your IOL, especially the plate haptic trinova, would it be horizontal or vertical, and would it make any difference?
Well, it depends on which type of you are doing, a temporal or a superior. So it basically it won't make much of a difference, because still it's better if it lies horizontally to the axis of the surgeon. That is what I mean. But it doesn't make any difference whether you have it horizontally or also put it vertically.
I think this question is being asked because the overall diameter of the lens is 11 millimeters.
Yeah.
And if you were to actually measure the horizontal and the vertical diameters of the bag, Dr. Anaga, would you like to comment something on that?
Yes, see, I usually sit temporally and take a temporal or a superotemporal incision. So I would feel that once you implant the lens into the bag, and then you see what is the white to white also of that patient. Now, if the white to white is really very large, and you feel that the lens is moving a little bit inside the eye, then maybe you can change the position to a horizontal only. But if the white to white is smaller and the snugly fit lens looks quite perfectly balanced and aligned, so I don't think that should really matter more. However, if it is a toric multifocal, not in this case, of course, then definitely we need to take care depending on what axis the lens is sitting. And in cases of the non-plate types, usually we also have to think about the negative dysphotopsia and whether there are any problems. Usually you have the nasal temporal position of the lens, which would decrease the amount of negative dysphotopsia.
A small thing I would like to add here is, in my experience, what I've noticed is, as Dr. Anaga showed at the end of surgery, that you would try to align the center of the lens to the Purkinje images of the microscope. So if they are not aligned, what I do is I keep rotating the lens to a final position where these images would be fairly in line with each other. And 99% of the times you find that location of the lens in the bag where this happens. You just need to give a little more time and rotate your lens. I'm talking about non-toric lenses, especially the multifocals and the trifocals. So that is my experience that I would like to share. A few more questions is, Dr. Sucheta, is there any preference why you would select a trinova lens over other trifocal lenses?
No, I have disclosed that one is, if it is available, like main is, they are talking about is this sinusoidal pattern, or that pattern which is there, and if it is taking care of your light loss more, that is what 8% loss only, and if you can give a good photopic dysfunction is not there in this patient, and they don't have much of halos and glares, which is actually taking care, and they have a good mesopic vision. So you have a range of more patients who can be given this lenses than having a cutoff of making certain patients who cannot be given.
Would both of you like to comment something on high myopic patients who would like to have independence from spectacles? What lens would be preferred, a plate haptic or a C loop or a single piece IL, I mean. Anaga?
Yeah. Definitely, if you were to, depends on the amount of myopia. If it's a moderate myopia, then definitely any of them would be good. In case of a very high myopia, usually they have larger capsular bags and their white to white is also a little higher. So a plate haptic lens would definitely be better, if, especially if it is a little longer lens, then it would more snugly fit into the capsular bag. Otherwise, the chance of it slightly rotating in the post-operative period is there. But you also have to remember that less than, say, now I think Trinova has a very good range, right, from even from less than around 5 also available. Many of the earlier trifocal lenses are not really available in the very, very high myopic range. So availability also becomes an issue. Plus, in these cases, we need to be very careful regarding the amount of PCO that they would develop. So you need to really do a good cortical cleanup and polishing of the posterior capsule so that they end up having very, very minimal PCOs. A hydrophobic lens in our conventional wisdom has been found to show much less PCO in these cases. So we really need to know and see in the future how these hydrophilic combined with hydrophobic lenses, hybrid lenses, actually behave in these group of patients.
Yeah, my comment similar, like very high myopias, I think it's this plate haptic may play a role, but if it is a, if you see that it is rotating, one thing we can do, we can give a capsular ring, not for this plate haptics, but in other cases, we can give a endocapsular ring and make it fit. And another thing is, you have to very clear like how much the myopia, what is the fundus status, like retina status, if they're having lot of staphyloma or that thing. So all those things also come into play before advising for a trifocal in those high myopia groups.
Maybe an OCT and is mandatory in these cases.
There is a question saying that the first eye has been implanted with a multifocal IOL. Now the second eye needs to be operated. So can you implant a trifocal in the second eye?
Yes, definitely. You can implant. I mean, if the first eye, do you know what kind of lens it was? If it was a bifocal lens also. And if you now want to implant a trifocal, there is no reason why you should not. First, assuming that the patient is happy. However, you also need to know what is the amount of residual refraction in the first eye. Assuming that the patient is emmetropic, 6x6, N6, but only complaint of intermediate vision is there, then definitely a trifocal would help. However, if there is some kind of residual refractive error, then you would have to do the necessary changes in the calculation.
Dr. Sucheta, for the knowledge of the audience, in your study of 19 cases, have you implanted a trifocal Trinova lens for a unilateral cataract patient?
No, I have not done any unifocal. I have not done in my study, no.
All your patients are bilaterally implanted Trinova sinusoidal lens?
Yeah.
But what is your experience if I was to implant a trifocal lens only in one eye and the other eye was not having any cataract?
You can still go ahead and do a trifocal, because some studies are showing if you see that one eye is, how much is the difference between the two eyes, refraction you can see. And if you see it is not much, the difference between the two eye, then you can go ahead and do a trifocal for one of the lenses. You can go ahead. It's not a no, but you have to see other parameters and then decide.
And then there are questions.
Can I make a comment on that?
Yeah. Sure. Go ahead, Anika.
Yeah, I have done in many cases where the other eye is as of now a clear lens. Considering the first scenario where the other eye is emmetropic and the patient is in the presbyopic age group, definitely we would be giving a good vision for distance, intermediate and near in the operated eye. So you have to hit emmetropia. That is point number one. Second thing is you have to counsel the patient that there would be a difference in the kind of vision in between the two eyes. So no matter that his dependence on the glasses is going to reduce, because at least one eye is going to have a trifocal vision. However, the change in the contrast sensitivity between the two eyes can be a little disturbing, and his balance and the focus between the two eyes could be a little different. So he needs to realize that there could be certain times when he would not be able to see so well for near, because the other eye is not going to help if he's not going to use glasses for the other eye. And till the time we operate the other eye, the actual summation of the multifocality for both the eyes would not be reached. So he needs to understand this. And if he's ready to accept that this is his condition, then definitely you go ahead. But if he feels that he has to be, he's a very demanding patient and not a very understanding patient, then I feel in such cases it's better not to go ahead with a multifocal. Secondly, if the other eye is almost say minus two or plus two, and there's going to be a lot of change in the refraction even between the two eyes, again this condition would necessitate him to use a glass in the other eye. So it's going to be a more complicated situation. Unless he accepts all this, it should not be done. If he accepts it, then only I think you should go ahead and do it.
I agree actually with this point, because one patient was there who had a minus 8 in one eye, and the other eye is a young patient, something to do with the 32 early cataract. So he was insisting. So he had heard from somewhere he wanted all this three visions. So it trifocal, basically that is what he was describing. But the thing is, yes, you have to understand the other factor which Anagha was saying. And even if you give them, then you can go ahead and do something, other surgery, refractive surgery in the other eye, only to balance it. Otherwise, it's very difficult to go ahead and...
also give them the option of contact lenses. I usually give them the option of contact lens in the other eye till the cataract develops. Yeah, and if they are already contact lens users, then it makes it even more easy for them to accept. Then it is a cakewalk. You really don't have to bother so much.
What is your preference for the biometry method to be used for premium IOLs, especially we are talking about trifocals? Is it a must that an optical biometry is necessary? And what is the amount of cylinder that you would still implant a trifocal, not a toric?
Yeah, see, for me, yes, optical biometry is the method of choice. However, if you do not have an optical biometry, then you should at least use a immersion biometry and not a applanation one, contact ultrasound method. Repeat the keratometric readings and the axial length readings and the biometry at least three times on three different occasions, so that you get consistent readings and repeatable readings. Even with an optical biometry, we are doing that for all our premium IOL patients. Most important is you need to do it on virgin eyes. See that the patient has not been instilled any dilating drop or anesthetic drop, and do it if the patient has any kind of poor tear film or a poor ocular surface, and prescribe lubricants and prescribed drops, and then do it after a few days, and then treat the ocular surface if required. So even though definitely optical biometry is the method of choice, but in cases where it is not accessible at all, you can still do it, but you should have repeatable readings with you.
Yeah, where you don't have a scenario of optical biometry, then you can go for this immersion method. But you have to do multiple times and be sure that what your readings are before you take up these cases. And you should use the advanced formula. Usually we use the Barrett formula in all the cases to find out alpha. That is very important. And just if you go and do some, it's not just as some people, they do this RK2 and then leave it, or that is not the thing. You can, if it is like a high myopia or something, then be consistent in these cases to do a particular formulas you have to use. And we usually use the Barrett's.
Yeah, definitely. The Barrett Universal 2 is the formula of choice. Regarding the second part of the question, how much amount of astigmatism, what we do is whatever is the astigmatism of the patient, unless it is of course zero, you put it in the Barrett toric calculator and see whether a toric lens is indicated in such a case. So So if you were to just go by the quantity wise, then 0.5 or less only I would do just a plain toric, plain trifocal. And if it is more than that, then they, or more than 0.75, definitely you would go for a multifocal toric one. So you put all the readings in a toric calculator, Barrett toric calculator online, and then see whether it is recommended or not. And then you can take a decision. That is much easier so that you get better visual outcome.
I think we've answered most of the questions from the people out there. And do you recommend a trifocal in post-refractive patients? An RK, a PRK, SMILE or a LASIK?
As I mentioned in my presentation, the first and foremost thing in all these cases are we know that the cornea is not going to be very symmetrical. Plus, because of the inaccuracy of the keratometric readings and the higher order aberrations like high positive corneal spherical aberrations in cases of post-myopic LASIK, and if there's a decentered ablation, higher chances of getting coma, definitely the contrast sensitivity is less and the quality of vision, especially night vision, is going to be less. Now, having said that, in many of the patients where there is a very good central uniform ablation, or like the case which I showed where there were just four cut RKs with a good topography, first of all, we need to do a pentacam in all these cases and see what is the amount of higher order aberrations, see whether the EKR histogram is showing how much of variability of the keratometric value in the zone that is you have checked. So if it has a good spike, like I showed in my case, and the patient can understand that there is going to be a chance of a residual refractive error, he might need to be treated for that. There is a chance of a poor contrast sensitivity. He might have to face glare and halos. After all this is done, and you know that you are going to do a good job, use only the Barrett True K values and the ASCRS online calculators, with all the care and precautions, probably in a good case, you can go ahead. However, if all these are not there, then definitely we should not go ahead, because you know that the visual outcomes are not going to be really promising.
My only point in asking this question was that you already have a very, very motivated patient. He has gone in for refractive surgery in the first case because he doesn't want to wear glasses. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So there, would you prefer a trifocal or would you prefer an EDOF lens to get him that contrast?
In fact, the best lens would be something like a monofocal, which gives you good intermediate, also something like an Eyhance, which would not give glare and halos at all, which doesn't have rings at all.
Still,
yes, the second choice would be an EDOF, where you would not have as many glare and halos as a proper typical multifocal. But yes, trifocal in a very perfect scenario and a very perfect kind of case where all the other problems are not there, you can still go ahead with it.
Thank you. Breaking news is, I have just received news from the company that the Trinova Toric is going to be launched very soon. Unfortunately, we are all staying at home. Nothing is moving. So as soon as the lockdown goes down, probably we'll have Trinova Torics. One last thing, if you would like to comment about the sinusoidal technology, anybody wants to say something on that? Is it something different to other lenses? Dr. Sucheta?
Yeah, basically what is happening, this sinusoidal, what technology they are using, that patent, what they have taken up the sharp edges which is there. Those other lenses, trifocals, were a overlap of the sharp edges which is there in that diffractive IOLs. And what they have done with this, they have done a surface modification where you have this stepless. They don't have a zones. The zones which are there, there is no demarcation line. That is what it goes on, like a sinusoidal pattern. So you look at the curves which is happening, it's like a smooth curve which is happening basically. So what they are saying that the transition loss of light between these two zones won't be there, and you get a seamless vision between all these zones. So loss of light which is not there basically, and that enhances the visual performance. That is what basically.
Your experience, Dr. Anaga.
See, the most important thing in any kind of diffractive multifocal lenses is the loss of light that occurs. So usually on an average around 15 to 20% light is lost, which is the most important reason why a multifocal IOL patient cannot see so well in dim light and read in dim light. Now in these in the Trinova lens, the transmission is almost as high as 92%, which means only 8% of the light is lost. Now, because of the increased transmission of light, definitely for near also, in the mesopic light conditions, the contrast is much better. So the reading is much better and the contrast clarity of the vision is also much better. So definitely the sinusoidal gratings, it gives you more a continuous or a seamless vision instead of a break or a discontinuity because of the sharp edges. So that gives an edge over the other lenses.
Another thing is they have a high modulation transfer factor. Okay, so the contrast sensitivity is also better in the tolerated in this case, this lenses than compared to the other lenses, trifocals.
So on that note, I think we've used up all our time now, and surely a lot of enlightening things that people would have understood from both of you. The Acriva Trinova is surely something of a game changer. And we look forward to using more and more of these lenses and would like to share our experiences. In these times of pandemic of COVID, I would just request everyone to stay home, stay safe, and take care. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Anaga. Thank you, Dr. Sucheta. And thank you, VSY Biotechnology.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Sachin and VSY.
Yeah, thank you.
A nice webinar and enlightening for all of us. Thank you so much.
And nice to meet all of you. And thanks to everyone.
Thanks a lot.